thank you for joining the 2020 Houston Area Parkinson Society Summer Lecture Series. Since 1974, HAPS has been the only organization in the area providing comprehensive services to the local Parkinson's community. Our mission remains the same since we started, to ensure that no one faces a Parkinson's diagnosis alone. This is the 10th year that HAPS has hosted the Summer Lecture Series, and what a year it has been. This is also the first year that we've hosted the series on a virtual platform. If you're familiar with this educational event, you know that our Summer Lecture Series is an opportunity to provide serious educational content in a relaxed environment with a fun summer theme. While it loses some of its effect virtually, we decided that given all the changes we've already encountered this year, it would be comforting to stick with what we know. I say all of this to explain the decorations, Hawaiian shirts, etc. Before we get started, I have several groups to thank. First, I want to thank our board, Board of Advisors, and Medical Advisory Board for their ongoing support and role in developing and implementing all of our educational programs. I want to thank staff for their never-ending hard work and creative input that really makes all of our events so special and meaningful. Third, I want to offer a sincere and big thanks to all of our sponsors. During a time when funding is critical and hard to come by, this group has remained steadfast in their commitment to our local Parkinson's community and to helping us ensure continuation of our mission. We remain grateful for their generous support and are proud to consider them partners in the work we do. Specifically, I want to thank our presenting partner, US World Meds, as well as Acadia, Acorda, Amneal, Boston Scientific, Medtronic, Synovian, Lundbeck, and UCB. Next, I want to thank our Parkinson's community for sticking together during times of uncertainty and for being patient as we work through this pandemic while adjusting all aspects of our service delivery, including today's program. And finally, I want to thank our presenters for their time and expertise, but also for being so accommodating during these evolving times. Quickly, I want to give you a rundown of the day. You will hear from our three speakers who will then join me for a question and answer session after the presentations are finished and before we join Dr. Maggie Abbott for her exciting movement lab. If you do not already have the handouts, you can access them on the HAPS website at hapsonline.org under the Summer Lecture Series section. The program includes full speaker bios, upcoming HAPS events and programs, information from our sponsors, and the presentations for these lectures. There will be a couple of brief breaks as we get set up for other aspects of the event, and in advance, I thank you for your patience. During the question and answer, we will be addressing the questions that the audience submits through the course of today's lectures. If you're participating in the live session, you have the option to submit questions through the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. We will only be monitoring the Q&A option and will not be monitoring the chat or raise your hand features during today's program. Okay, now on to what we've all been waiting for. I'd like to introduce our first speaker of the series. Dr. Desiree Thomas is a local neurologist, member of the American Association of Neurology, and HAPS Medical Advisory Board. She attended medical school at Baylor College of Medicine and completed her neurology fellowship at Emory University. Dr. Thomas joined Kelsey Siebold in 2006, where she continues her practice. Welcome, Dr. Thomas.
Hello, everyone. I'm glad you guys were able to join us this morning. So I'm Dr. Desiree Thomas. I work over at Kelsey Siebold Clinic. Let me go to my next slide. I put this picture here so you could see what I look like pre-pandemic. So if you come to see me in person, you won't have any confusion. Kelsey Siebold Clinic is here in Houston only. We have lots of locations. I work at the main campus, which is in the medical center, and I also work out in Sugar Land. It's a nice clinic because we have all the different specialties all in one roof. So I see all types of patients, headache patients, Alzheimer's patients, but I also see patients with Parkinson's. So that's what we'll be talking about today. I don't have any disclosures to report. So I wanted to start by saying sometimes when you have Parkinson's, you can feel like, why me? But sometimes you have to ask, why not me? So there's people from every walk of life that have Parkinson's disease. Here's a couple celebrities that have it. So Ozzy Osbourne has it. And then most of you know about Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali, it's thought that he got it more because of all of the blows to the head post-concussion. So here's a few facts about Parkinson's. Men actually are 1.5 times more likely than women to have Parkinson's disease. There's lots of different reasons. So we just talked about Muhammad Ali, it might have been from head trauma. Sometimes people have genetic factors. There are a lot of people that have had strokes. And so because of the change in circulation to the brain, that can cause changes of Parkinson's. Sometimes people have environmental exposures or toxins. I have a lot of patients that might have served in a war or patients that have worked at different plants, and there's thought that there might have been some environmental exposures. But most of the patients that I see with Parkinson's, it's called idiopathic, which means we're not sure why they have Parkinson's. The onset is usually over 50 years of age, but as we know with Michael J. Fox, it can happen earlier, but most patients, it's in older age. Another thing that I should say is that not everyone that has tremor has Parkinson's disease. I see a lot of patients that are a little shaky, and they're worried about that. So it's always important before you self-diagnose yourself or look on Google too much to know that a lot of people can have tremor and it's not Parkinson's. So it's important to see someone so they can help you figure it out. Another thing I should say is that there are some patients that have what's called atypical Parkinson's or Parkinson's plus. These are patients that might have some tremor or other symptoms, but they're have other symptoms. So for instance, there's Lewy body dementia where you might have a lot of hallucinations early on. There's cortical basal degeneration. There's MSA or multiple systems atrophy where you might have a lot of blood pressure issues. There's progressive supranuclear palsy where you might have a lot of issues moving your eyes. It's important to identify those because some of the treatments that we'll talk about later don't always work as well for those types of patients, but there are still things that we can do. And one of the things we'll be talking about later is slurred speech or dysarthria. And some of these patients will have that as one of their first symptoms. So when we see that, these are some of the things that sometimes we think about. So Parkinson's disease happens because there's a chemical that our brain needs called dopamine. And so patients with Parkinson's lose the cells in the brain that are supposed to make the dopamine. So you can see on the slide, the top picture, there's a little brown line. They call this the midbrain. It kind of looks like Mickey Mouse. So in his ears, you can see that on the bottom picture, there's lack of brown, and that's the cells that make the dopamine. So if you looked at a brain underneath the microscope, or if you were dissecting a brain and you got to this part of the brain, that's what it would look like if you had Parkinson's. So that's easy enough. If you looked and that's what you saw, then you know the patient has Parkinson's. But obviously in real life, we're not going to do slicing up of your brain. So in real life, it can be a little bit more difficult to make the diagnosis. So we have to listen to your symptoms in order to figure out if that might be what you have. So this is a picture of someone that kind of has all of the classic symptoms of Parkinson's. Parkinson's can make you have tremor. It can slow you down. So sometimes I have people come in and their main symptom is that they just can't keep up with other people. It seems like everyone is leaving them behind. It can make you very stiff and rigid, and it can affect your gait or your balance. So another reason people might get sent to see me is because they're having lots of falls and nobody can figure out why. And so if you have someone that's having those symptoms, then that might make us think about Parkinson's. Again, I like to emphasize that just because you have the first one and you don't have the other ones, then that doesn't necessarily mean you have Parkinson's. Another thing I'd like to add is that sometimes at the very beginning, the symptoms are very subtle. And so sometimes you have to stick with your doctor. So just because you see the doctor the first time and they're not able to tell you exactly what they think you have, sometimes it's good to follow up with them later. Sometimes people are expecting that you see the doctor once and they're just going to figure it all out. But sometimes, you know, these things take time to kind of declare themselves. So if you see the doctor and they're not quite sure what's going on, then, you know, make a follow-up appointment so that you can get reevaluated, because sometimes over time we can tell what's going on where at the beginning it wasn't exactly clear. So a lot of times people think about some of the other symptoms of Parkinson's like an iceberg. So you can see part of the iceberg, but underneath there's all these other symptoms that aren't as visible, not as easy to see. So some of those things are, there's lots of automatic things that our body does, breathing, swallowing, our heart rate. So sometimes people with Parkinson's will have a lot of issue controlling their blood pressure. So if you stand up too fast, then all of a sudden you feel dizzy, like you're going to pass out, or sometimes people even do pass out. Some patients will have drooling. So we'll talk about that in a minute. Some people have dysphagia, which is a fancy word for swallowing. Constipation, which sometimes can be from the medicine, sometimes from the disease. It can affect your bladder and how you can control your urination. It can cause sexual dysfunction. It can affect your blood pressure, like we just talked about. It can affect your speech, and it can affect your sweating. So sometimes people will just, you know, it's not even hot outside and they feel very sweaty. Back to sexual dysfunction. I think that's hard sometimes, especially if you're a man and you have a female neurologist. So you're like, oh, I don't want to talk about that, and vice versa. But most doctors have heard it all times two. So it's, you know, if there's something that's bothering you, it's important to talk to your doctor about it. Also remember that doctors are human. So sometimes we're a little bit nervous about talking about these things. So just because we don't ask doesn't mean you shouldn't ask. So sometimes there's this elephant in the room, but you know, if there's something bothering you. And again, that's the other thing about developing a relationship with your doctor, because if you guys get to know each other well, then sometimes it's not as uncomfortable to bring these things up. So some other symptoms that you might have if you have Parkinson's: you might have difficulty sleeping. You might sleep way too much. You might not be able to get to sleep at night. You might have problems with acting out your dreams. I have a patient that was a police officer, and so in his dreams, he was trying to get the bad guy and punching his wife. So that can be a problem. Sometimes it can affect your memory and make you even think things that aren't true. So it can make you very paranoid, thinking someone's trying to get you, or thinking that someone's stealing your things. And then it can also cause problems with your mood, depression, anxiety, not just because you have the disease, but just the chemical changes in your brain can make you anxious or depressed. It can affect your sense of smell and hearing, and it can just make you very tired. So there's all of these things that are kind of under the surface. So again, if someone's shaking, then that's easy to see. But some of these other things people might not even realize could be Parkinson's. So it's important to tell your doctor all the things that are bothering you. So this is very complicated. People wonder, well, how could Parkinson's cause all these different things? But I won't try to explain this whole slide, but basically there's all these different parts of the brain that have to work in sync and coordinate with each other to have the thought of wanting to do something go through your brain, down through your spinal cord, and down to your mouth or to your hands or to your legs or to your heart. So if you have a problem where those signals aren't connecting, or the chemicals that are supposed to be produced to make those signals happen aren't working, then that can cause all of the symptoms we see in Parkinson's. So it can start to cause problems with your speech, where your speech isn't loud enough, or it can cause the movement of your mouth not to be coordinated with your tongue so that your speech isn't right. So all of those things are what contribute to problems with speech and swallowing. So we'll go on to talk about that. So this picture shows when you go to swallow, what exactly happens. And we have some speech pathologists that'll be talking to us in a little bit in more detail. So when you go to drink, your tongue is there and your tongue has to move out of the way so that the liquid or the pills that you take move down into your throat and then down into your stomach. So there's a very complex mechanism that makes all that things happen. So drooling can be a problem with Parkinson's. It might be one of the more embarrassing symptoms of Parkinson's. I have a patient that would come and see me, and he would always, this was pre-pandemic, he'd want to give me a kiss on the cheek, but he would always say, hey, it's going to be a little sloppy. And so he would kiss me, and yes, there'd be a little extra there. It's just something that goes along with it, but luckily there are things that we can do about it. There are medicines that we can use to kind of dry up your mouth. The only problem with that is that if we dry up your mouth, it can make other things move slow. So it can make you have difficulty going to the bathroom or constipation or even slow down your memory. So sometimes we have to kind of balance those things out. Something that I, even though I've been a neurologist for a while, hadn't heard of until recently was some eye drops that you can use to dilate your eyes. You can take a few drops of that and put it underneath your tongue, and that temporarily dries up your mouth. So that can be a treatment, and it's very inexpensive. Then there's also Botox. So the same stuff that we use for wrinkles can be used for a lot of different things, including trying to kind of paralyze the salivary gland so it can't make as much saliva, therefore then you can't drool as much. And then of course there's swallowing therapy through the speech pathologist, and they'll talk to you about that in a little bit. So another issue that you might have with your Parkinson's is your swallowing or dysphagia. A lot of people don't even think to mention that to the doctor, but your throat is just, there's muscles in there. So it can lead you not to be able to get as much food as you need because you're not able to swallow it. It can make you dehydrated because you might avoid drinking. And unfortunately, things can go the wrong way when you're trying to drink and you can get a pneumonia. Some places say it's only 20% of patients with Parkinson's, and I've seen other places that say that up to 100% of patients with Parkinson's eventually will have some issues with their swallowing. It's usually later when you have Parkinson's, so it's not usually the first symptoms that we see. So it's something that we start to see later on. But again, sometimes your doctor gets busy and you're talking about other stuff and they don't get to this question. But if you're noticing you're having a hard time swallowing your pills or you're having to chop up your food really fine, then that's something to talk to your doctor about so we can see if we can help. Another thing that might prompt you to know that you have problems swallowing, things kind of get stuck. Your voice might feel kind of wet. If you keep getting pneumonia, nobody knows why, that could be a symptom. If you're losing weight, I do have patients that just in general don't like swallowing pills, but these pills, I mean, they actually, even the smallest pills will get stuck. And then if you're coughing or choking a lot when you're trying to eat, that could be a sign. So as far as treating problems with your speech or problems with your swallowing, there are some of the medicines that we use for Parkinson's might also help with this. But unfortunately, the medicines that we use to help tremor and some of the other features of Parkinson's, they might not help your swallowing as much. Sometimes patients will get deep brain stimulation to help. In some cases, just depending on where the leads are, that can make your issues with your speech or swallowing worse, so we have to be careful. And then I think overall speech therapy is going to be your best bet for helping with your speech and your swallowing. As far as speech goes, you might notice that people keep telling you to speak up. I have a naturally low voice, so people tell me to speak up all the time, but if you're someone that's usually very loud and now all of a sudden people say they can't hear you, that could be a sign. Sometimes people, their mouth gets ahead of them, so it might come out as a mumble. Sometimes your speech comes out in bursts. But all of that is because the throat muscles and the tongue, everything isn't coordinating, and that can result in speech problems. So as I kind of conclude, I can't go on without showing you my family. So this is my daughter and our dog, Loki. My daughter is going to be going to University of Oregon, go Ducks. My middle son is 15, and my little son, Darian, is 10. So they, when you have family, sometimes they have to sacrifice a little bit of your time in order to, let mom do the work. So I appreciate them kind of letting me do my job, including this morning being here with you. So finally, this is Mr. Freetag. He was a very active participant in HAPS. I don't know if any of you guys got to meet him. He's a very lovely man, and he was my patient. It's really unfortunate how you get to know someone sometimes better in death than you knew them in life. There was so much of a story that he had before he was my patient that I learned after he passed away. But he was a really good guy, and he always spurred me to do more with HAPS. So I just wanted to kind of be a shout out to him today. So that concludes my talk. I'm glad that you guys got to tune in and listen a little bit. So I'm going to turn it back over to Kathleen. Thank you very much.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Thomas, for all of that wonderful information. You're right. Ellis was a huge champion for HAPS, and he is. We continue to miss him. Okay. As a reminder, Dr. Thomas will join our next two speakers following their presentation for our question and answer session. Don't forget, if you're watching live, you can submit your questions through the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. So make sure that you do that so that we can make sure that everyone ends today getting your questions answered. So I'm going to introduce our next two speakers together, as they're going to be delivering the content as a team. Danielle DeVore is a clinical educator at University of Houston in the Department of Communication Sciences and Disorders. She leads a team that specializes in helping individuals with Parkinson's regain and maintain their ability to speak through Speak Out and the Loud Crowd. Megan Joseph is a clinical educator at University of Houston Speech, Language, and Hearing Clinic. She provides clinical supervision and instruction to graduate students treating adults with cognitive, communication, and swallowing disorders resulting from neurologic injuries. Both of these speakers are speech language pathologists here to share informative and practical information with us. So welcome, Danielle and Megan. Sorry, I'm going to change the slideshow. Give me one second. Okay, Danielle.
Hi, I'm Danielle DeVore. I will be leading part of this presentation covering dysarthria and voice.
And I'm Megan Joseph, and I will be starting with the swallowing portion.
Just briefly, just a little disclosures. Megan and I are both employees. Megan receives salary and support from the University of Houston, and I also receive salary from the University of Houston and Texas Children's. There's no other financial disclosures. Learning objectives. Some of the things we would like you to take away from this presentation today, will be able to explain what is considered a normal swallow, speech and voice quality. You'll be able to identify signs and symptoms of abnormal speech, voice, and swallowing. And you'll be able to discuss how speech, voice, and swallowing may be impacted by Parkinson's disease. So I'll pass it over to Megan, and she'll start with the swallowing.
Thank you, Danielle. Okay, now you can get to see my full face. Whether that's a good thing or not, I don't know. We are going to start with talking about a normal swallow, because I believe it's important we need to talk about what is normal so that when something changes, we'll know what the difference is. So on the slides, you'll get a link to some videos that pull up on YouTube that'll show what normal swallowing looks like. And then later on, there'll be some links that you could pull up at home for disordered swallowing. But we're going to go over the normal swallow. These are some pictures that sort of show the what happens when you start eating or drinking. So the green is what we call it a bolus of food, meaning it's just like a bite of food that you take. And we chew it, and then as soon as it starts to go towards the back of our mouth, it moves towards the throat, like you can see in the second picture. And the airway closes off, and the green material is starting to go down towards the stomach. And then picture number three, you can see that it is now past the throat and it's going towards the stomach. So that's what should happen with a normal swallow. So there's three phases of swallowing. We have the oral phase, which is could be known as the mouth phase. Everything that happens in the mouth when you swallow, we consider in the oral phase. So that includes biting, chewing, drinking, sipping, anything that prepares the material to be swallowed. So then once it gets past the mouth phase, it goes to the throat phase or the pharyngeal phase. So that's when it's gotten into the throat. You'll notice you might have a feeling of the food or liquid being in the throat around the area of your Adam's apple. And that also happens, like if you cough potentially when you're eating or drinking, you feel like things are left over after you swallow, that would all be happening during your pharyngeal phase. And then your esophageal phase or the stomach phase is when you finish swallowing the foods and liquids and the esophageal sphincter is moving the food and liquids down towards the stomach. So we don't, as speech pathologists, have anything to do really with the esophageal phase. We leave that to our GI doctor friends. But we can help identify potential issues that the esophageal phase would be causing the pharyngeal phase. So for instance, reflux. If you have reflux, we always tell people to not lie down immediately after you eat. And that's because the stomach acids that are refluxing back up the esophagus can actually make their way into the throat. And then because of the position that you're lying in, it makes it a little bit easier for you to aspirate or food and liquid going down the wrong way.
So we can identify concerns for that, and we give recommendations for, you know, things like, you know, wait 30 minutes before you lie down. The other thing that we can identify is the very top of the esophageal phase. We have at the top of our esophagus, we have what's called the upper esophageal sphincter, which is a muscle that will relax to allow food and liquid to go down to our stomach. And sometimes certain injuries like strokes, there's a certain kind of stroke that can cause that muscle to not relax when we are eating, and then the food and liquid will just stay kind of on top of the esophagus, building up more in the throat, which can increase the aspiration risk. So as far as those two issues, that's about where we stop with esophageal issues, and then we send it on to our friends. So if this is really hard to do a demonstration when I can't see you at home, but if you happen to have a glass of water or something to drink nearby, grab it, and then maybe grab something to eat. Could be anything, really. Cracker, cookie, fruit, vegetable, applesauce, something. Because I just want to show you what it will look like, what a swallow should look like and feel like. So I guess I'll talk for a minute and let you get your materials ready. What we're going to be looking for first is your Adam's apple. So the Adam's apple is the bony portion of your throat that kind of sticks out a little bit. So find your Adam's apple and do a swallow and see what happens when you swallow. I'm going to try to do it as well, mouth a little dry. So you should have felt the Adam's apple go up, and you should have also felt it go forward just a little bit. And so that is our voice box. That's the other word for the Adam's apple that I try to tell people instead of using all the medical terminology. But it's supposed to go up and out because it does that to help protect our airway against anything entering it. We're going to show some more pictures later, but basically I like to look at, I always use my hand as the tongue. So if you're looking at it from the side, the tongue will form a ramp basically, and it pushes the food and liquid down. So it does that, but also the helper is the voice box elevating so that it really protects that airway from anything going down. So hopefully you felt yours move up. Hopefully you felt yours move out. And then also kind of think, what's your tongue doing? You know, was your tongue, was it moving a lot? Did it stay still? What should have happened is your tongue, as you were getting ready to swallow, the tip at least, should have gone up towards the top of your mouth to create a nice seal. And that helps build pressure up to push everything down towards your throat. So now I think I've talked enough that maybe you have everything ready. So let's start with a drink of water. So I want you to just take a couple sips of water, and I want you to first notice what your mouth is doing, the mouth phase. So because it's water or something, or Coke or something, it's quick. So you should have felt your tongue go towards the top of your mouth and then help push that liquid down. You may have felt the liquid be a little bit in the front of your throat around that Adam's apple for just a second, and then you swallowed. Now do another sip of the liquid. And after this time, I want you to swallow and then say, ah. And so hopefully your vocal quality is clear. We do this when we assess swallow function in adults. We will have them drink and we'll have them say, ah. And if we happen to hear any kind of wet sound, it could be an indication that liquids are going down the wrong way. Now take a bite of whatever you have in front of you. And I want you to kind of pay attention to what your mouth is doing as you're chewing. So your mouth should be moving in kind of a rotary fashion, so back and forth. Your tongue is going to be going to each side of your mouth to help form it into that bolus that we talked about, so the ball. And then it'll do the same thing it did for your liquids. Your tongue should go up to help seal the cavity, and then it'll push the foods down towards your throat. And after you swallow, see if you have any sensation of food being stuck in your throat. Hopefully you don't, and hopefully you don't have any coughing, but that can happen sometimes with swallowing difficulties. But I just wanted you to get an idea. We never think about swallowing. It's just something we do. And so I think it goes to show how many things have to happen to have a good swallow. And if any one of those, if any of it is impaired or not working as well, then you can really have a problem swallowing. So we've talked about normal swallowing. Now let's talk about disordered swallowing. There will be a link at the bottom of the video of a disordered swallow, just to give you an idea of what we as speech pathologists look at and how we identify that somebody's aspirating. But in this picture, you can see our same person that we saw in the pictures before. There's that green food or liquid that they've been swallowing, but this time, instead of it going down as it should, down towards the stomach, there's a little bit of the green that fell out and is going down the throat or the airway. And so that's what we call aspiration. And so that's what we always worry about and we look at in any individual, because if you keep aspirating, it can lead to aspiration pneumonia, which is very serious. The fancy medical term for difficulty swallowing is dysphagia. So if you ever hear that, now you know what that means. It just means difficulty moving foods or liquids from the mouth to the stomach. It can occur at any of the stages that we mentioned, oral, pharyngeal, or esophageal. And it can occur with anything, any person, any age, any etiology. I listed some common etiologies down below, neuromuscular, and you'll notice Parkinson's is on there, and neurological, so stroke, brain injury, spinal cord injury. This is not an inclusive list. I mean, there are many different ways that someone can show that they're having dysphagia, but these are pretty common signs and symptoms. So take a look at the list and just always kind of be cognizant if you're starting to experience some of these symptoms. Because it can be in any phase of the swallow, you know, if the oral phase, if you're drooling a lot more, like I know Dr. Thomas was mentioning controlling saliva. So that is, it can also be extended into how well you're managing food in your mouth as well. So maybe you have food and liquid coming out. Maybe you have food hanging out in your pockets of your mouth. Tongue pumping, which we'll talk about in a minute, which is very common with people with Parkinson's disease. The other thing to listen for is coughing or throat clearing before, during, or after meals. And if you've been sick a lot recently, that might be something that you want to consider, like going to visit the doctor. Weight loss for no reason, and kind of significant weight loss. You're not trying to lose weight, but you've lost a pretty significant amount of weight in a short amount of time. That wet, gurgly vocal quality I talked about, so it'll just sound like you need to really clear your throat after you've eaten. And then also complaining of swallowing difficulty with like food being stuck. I've swallowed and I just feel like it's still here. All of those are the ones I hear probably the most commonly. But again, this is not an inclusive list. So I wanted to also break down sort of more typical signs and symptoms of dysphagia and Parkinson's disease. So that tongue pumping that I was mentioning before, what that looks like on an x-ray. So again, here's my tongue. Normally what happens, our tongue's chewing, helping us chew, and then it ramps up, like we said. But the tongue pumping is a back and forth motion while we're chewing and while we're trying to push the foods and liquids towards the back of the throat. But it's kind of an inefficient way to manage our food because it's just a constant, the bolus is moving back and forth, but it's not always getting back towards the back of the throat. And so what we try to do in that, if it's really becoming an issue where we can't really get a lot of nutrition in, we'll consider sort of changing the diet a little bit to make it easier to chew foods or even something that's really, really soft, like applesauce or yogurt. The other thing that can happen is a delay in the swallow. So normally when we chew, depending on what we're chewing, that phase could be about 15 to 20 seconds. But as soon as it gets to our throat, we should complete the swallow in about 1 to 2 seconds. It's very fast. What can start to happen with Parkinson's disease when our muscles start to get a little bit weaker, the larynx, the voice box that's supposed to elevate, it might still elevate, but it might take a couple extra seconds to get started. And so the food is sitting in your larynx, in your throat, it's waiting for a couple seconds, and then the swallow triggers. And so that can be problematic, because if it's sitting in there for an extended period of time, you're still breathing. And so your airway could suck some of that food or liquid down towards your airway and you could choke and or aspirate. So that's why we get a little concerned when the swallow starts to get delayed. And then you could start feeling increased residue in your throat after swallowing. Again, that feeling of, something's right here. And it generally, you feel that more with thicker foods or heavier foods than you will with like thin liquids, like water, for instance. And in the later stages of disease, significant weakness can occur that will sort of prevent the airway from being protected at all. And so that's when we really start worrying about aspiration pneumonia. So this is a sort of a, I don't want to say a typical progression of dysphagia and Parkinson's disease, because there really isn't a typical progression. Every person is different. But you can sort of keep this as a loose guideline for kind of keeping watch on what's happening with your eating and drinking. So what normally starts happening in the very early phases is you might just have some trouble with the oral phase. So you might have that tongue pumping that I talked about. You might have trouble chewing those more difficult foods. But otherwise, everything else down here is functioning fine. And then as the disease starts to progress, you'll move to maybe dysphagia in the oral and the pharyngeal phase. So you might have that increased residue in your throat after you swallow. You might have a little bit more coughing, throat clearing when you are swallowing. And then if the later stages, if someone happens to develop dementia at the later stages of the disease, feeding and swallowing can become more difficult. You may have trouble following directions. Your taste buds might have changed, and so you may not like the same things that you liked before, which can lead to difficulties with getting your adequate nutrition. And one thing I like to mention, I know Dr. Thomas is a much better person to talk about this, but timing of your Parkinson's medications is extremely important for swallowing. If you want to make sure that you're timing your meds with the amount of time before your breakfast and your last meal of the day, because even just a slight change that medication can really impact how your muscles are working, which then can impact how well you're swallowing. So just kind of keep that in mind. But all questions directed to her, I won't know how to answer those as well. So these are going to be some more videos you can watch at home, but I wanted to just do still, there's some pictures that show on the right. It's a swallow that should have started, but it's delayed. So you'll see that there is some food and liquid just kind of just hanging out in his throat. So that's problematic, because if he's breathing, you see all that's still in his throat. Any part of that or all of that could get sucked into his airway. What we're looking at, the airway is this white part here in the front of the throat. And then this part is the esophagus. And then over here on the left, it's a little hard to see, but this person has already swallowed, and all of this is left over in the throat. And so that's also problematic, because you can definitely breathe that material in as well. Okay, so how do we as speech pathologists evaluate a swallow, and how do you know when you need to get your swallow assessed? We're gonna go over that. So the first thing for us is we always have to have a physician order to complete an evaluation. So you can get that from any of your physicians. Dr. Thomas can write one, any of your PCPs. We just need to have the physician sign off on that. And once you come and see us, we're gonna get a really thorough case history from you. Specifically, we wanna know things about when your swallow started to kind of be different. Have you changed your diet? Are you avoiding certain foods because they're hard? Tell us what is happening when you swallow. Are you coughing? Do you constantly have that wet vocal quality? Do you feel that the food is stuck? We want to know those things. And then what we'll do is like I had you drink your water and eat something, we're going to do that with you in the office or the hospital, wherever we're working. So we're going to give you like little samples of some foods of different consistencies. So the really soft food and then the hard food, and as well as liquids. We'll start with water, and then sometimes we might have to thicken the water if you're having trouble at bedside. And so we'll watch for all those signs and symptoms that I listed earlier. And we'll also take into account, you know, what you've told us too in your case history. But generally, that's just our first assessment, and it will always lead to an instrumental assessment, which are the two kinds that we have is the, I'll go back to this slide in a minute, FEES on the left and MBS on the right. So a modified barium swallow is what MBS stands for. And that's the one where you'll, when you click on the videos, those will be the videos that you see are modified barium swallow studies. So they're x-rays that are conducted with us and a radiologist. And so it's the view that you're seeing is kind of how I was explaining the tongue. So it's the side view. And then this is a good slide to show you where all of our landmarks are. But the thing that we really worry about, I mean, we look at everything because that helps us get together a good treatment plan for you. But what we really worry about too is this area here, this white part where our airway is. Because if anything goes in that, that's aspiration. That's where you're at risk for aspiration pneumonia. We like it, this test specifically, because it allows for real-time assessment of what's happening when you swallow. I mean, it's not a whole meal. It's a very limited amount of time that you're under x-ray, but it does give us a good snapshot of what's happening. So from this, we'll develop diet recommendations, we'll develop a treatment plan with swallowing strategies and all of that good stuff. We also have the one on the left where you see you're looking at the larynx, the voice box. It's called the fiber optic endoscopic evaluation of swallowing, which is why we call it FEES, because that is a mouthful. But it's another view. It's still a real-time view of the swallow, just from a different angle. This one, you have to, it's a scope, and it's usually, we can do it by ourselves at bedside or in the clinic. Sometimes we'll do it with an ENT. It's the same concept as if you've ever been to an ENT and they scope you, laryngoscopy. It's the same kind of concept, but we're looking at swallowing. We're not really looking at, we're looking at your vocal folds, but we're mostly looking at what happens when you swallow. We have to have a physician order to complete it, just like we do with this first test that we do in the clinic, just like we do with the modified barium swallow study, and then just this one. We always have to have a physician sign off. And so this one is like a flexible tube, has a camera and a light on the end of it. It goes through your nose, which I will say that is the most uncomfortable part, but it's not terrible. And then as soon as we pass down towards like the back of the nose and down towards the front, it provides a view from above of your larynx. And so that's what we are seeing here in this top picture. This is the epiglottis, or the flap, the flapper, as I've heard it called. And so, and these are your vocal folds. They're the tiny things at the center of the picture. And then these are some muscles that help the larynx close when we swallow to help protect. And over here, you don't see it, but hopefully you can see my mouse. And that is where the esophagus is. It's the top of your screen, or the top of that picture. So this is also a good assessment, and you can more easily do it. Like I usually work in the hospitals, and so this test can be done. I mean, if you wanted to, you could do it every day. You're not going to, but the difference with this one versus the modified is that's under X-ray, and it's a little bit of radiation. So there's a little bit more risk with that one versus this one. I mean, you can do it all the time. But what I don't necessarily enjoy about it is that there's a couple second or half second where you can't see anything because you're swallowing. And as you swallow, it blocks the camera. And so a lot could be happening during that swallow that we don't see. And we have to kind of infer what has happened after you give us a nice view after the swallow. So I personally would probably still do a modified barium swallow and then maybe follow up with these fees at bedside. But that's just my personal opinion. They're all very good. And I would almost always recommend one of these tests when getting to the treatment portion, because you don't ever want to, it's just like, you know, doing your own physical therapy exercises, but never actually getting assessed with that. You don't know what's going to work. So with swallowing, we need to see exactly what's going on with your swallowing, because just kind of throwing out any kind of strategy or any kind of exercise, it may not even be targeting what's really happening. So always get that assessed first. And with dysphagia treatment, we really think of three questions that need to be answered. What type of nutritional management is necessary? Should therapy be initiated? And if so, what type? And then long-term goals. So management of dysphagia can include, like, we're going to change the foods, liquids a little bit. We're going to give you some compensatory strategies, and then maybe give you some treatment. So compensatory strategies are maneuvers that are utilized to improve the safety of the swallow and the efficiency, but it's not gonna target what's actually happening. It's just gonna make it a little easier for you. And again, I just wanna emphasize this because it should only be assigned by a speech pathologist after it's been assessed, because I've just been around a lot of people that sometimes will think it's helping. Like, let's say, I'll go over one of these in a minute, the chin tuck. We hear that a lot. Chin tuck, when we swallow, tuck your chin, and it's supposed to be a safer swallow. It is sometimes. But I have also done these instrumental assessments and seen someone do a chin tuck, and it was horrible. It was making the swallow worse. So you don't always know it's helping. These strategies here, I feel like, never hurt anyone. I mean, if we all take smaller bites and sips, that's great. So that's, I can say this is probably a generally good thing to do for everybody. Alternate, you know, take a couple bites of food, take your sip of liquid to help clear any residue that might be in your throat. And then if you do have that feeling of something getting stuck, take a couple more swallows, just dry swallows to help push it down after you swallow. And always have good oral care, especially if you start experiencing symptoms of dysphagia. We want to make sure that you're really keeping your mouth clean, because any kind of issue in your mouth that's like, if you have, you know, that your mouth isn't clean or it's starting to develop like a yeast on your tongue, that can make you sicker. So you always want to keep your mouth really clean. Now, these are compensatory strategies that we do assign after assessment. So that chin tuck that I talked about, so you put your chin all the way down to your chest, and what that does is it's supposed to help protect the airway even more when you swallow. Some people have to do a head turn when they swallow, depending on what side is weaker, which we can only see under x-ray in the fees a little bit. The effortful swallow, that one is really common, and I do prescribe that after I've assessed really easy, a lot, because it's easy. Some of these that I will mention, actually I don't even know if I'm mentioning them because they're pretty hard to do. The effortful swallow is just a hard swallow. So imagine that you're swallowing peanut butter, and you know how peanut butter gets stuck in your throat. Just swallow hard, push all those muscles, and then they'll help push it down towards your stomach. That's an easy one to do. And then diet texture modifications could include, like I said, soft foods that are easier to chew. So we might say, maybe avoid that hamburger for now. We'll give you something that has maybe some sauce on it, or that's been baked and has not a lot of moisture. And then puree foods, that would be more of a last resort, because people don't typically like their foods to be pureed. So it is easy. So if you ever need something kind of in a pinch, very easy to do. And then thickened liquids. So sometimes when thin liquids, as you may have noticed when you swallowed the water earlier, happens really fast. You swallow like that. And so sometimes if you're having trouble swallowing, that could happen too fast for you. And so we'll suggest thickening your liquids, which you can get at any store, basically. Walmart, Amazon has it. And so it'll just make it a little thicker, so it goes down a little slower. And then these other ones are things that you might hear, avoiding straws. Maybe we can test that on the assessment. Sometimes it's better for you. Sometimes it's worse. There are certain things you can buy that actually measure out how much you get at one time. They have volume measured cups that only give 5 cc's or 10 cc's at a time. So no matter how much you tilt it back, it only gives you that much until you tilt it down again and back. So it can be frustrating, but it helps. And plate guards, weighted utensils, those are things that I usually work in conjunction with occupational therapists, because they do a lot with the feeding part of swallowing. But hopefully that gave you a good sort of overview of everything that goes into evaluating and treating swallowing. Of course, we are here for questions after this is over. And now my part is over, and I'm gonna introduce my good friend Danielle. She's gonna talk to you about speech and voice.
All right, aloha, I'm Danielle DeVore. I'll be covering speech disorders and voice disorders as it pertains to Parkinson's disease. First, I just wanna clarify just a little bit, what's the difference between a speech and voice? So voice, as we know, is just a sound source that's traveling through your throat, through your larynx, and comes out your mouth. Once that sound travels through, then it's shaped by your mouth and your articulators, and that's speech. So you could have an impairment in both, or just one. So either impairment in the sound quality, the volume, the harshness, the roughness if you sound hoarse, or you can have a problem in how you are articulating those words that come out. So first we're gonna talk about the disorders of speech. So speech disorders results from a neurologic impairment affecting the motor planning, programming, neuromuscular control, or execution of speech. So some of the signs and symptoms of dysarthria, which is the technical term for disorders of speech, could be variable speaking rate, meaning sometimes the speaking rate could be very slow, or sometimes it can be too fast. It can also be articulation, so imprecise articulation, or slurred speech. So your speech is kind of slurred and a little drawn out and a little slower. It can also involve reduced coordination for breathing and speaking, meaning someone may run out of breath when talking and may try to talk when inhaling instead of exhaling. So that kind of looks like I'm trying to talk and you're kind of taking that big breath on the inhale and trying to speak at the same time. So that coordination between breathing and talking, which is a normal automatic response, can be impaired. So what does speech disorder or dysarthria look like in people with Parkinson's disease? So you may see monotone speech and volume, so meaning they kind of just speak at a very flat rate. You can see reduced prosody in voice, which means the melodic quality of the voice is missing. So, you know, in some questions you would see, what's going on? And people would rise up at the end of that phrase. With people with Parkinson's disease who may have dysarthria, you may see them kind of say, what's going on? Where typically you would see a rise in intonation. Again, reduced in volume and voice. People have difficulty being heard, especially in noisy situations. One key feature that you would often see is short rushes of speech, meaning some sentences and phrases will be produced faster than others. So you would say, how are you today? How are you today? I'm doing fine. You know, how are you? How is it going? So they would start off really slow and then kind of trail off and get really fast at the end. So that's kind of the gist of if it's involved in a speech disorder. Now I'm going to move on to what it looks like to have a voice disorder. So again, a voice disorder is the sound of the voice coming out, occurs when the vocal quality involving the pitch or loudness differs in you based on your age and gender. So what are some of the early signs of voice disorder in people with Parkinson's disease? Again, reduced vocal volume, hoarse sounding vocal quality. So you honestly, like they have a sore throat. And it could fluctuate, but it could occur. Frequent throat clearing. So you're having a conversation and you're healthy, generally healthy, haven't had a cold or no allergies, and you're just, you kind of just feel something's at the back of your throat. These could be some of the early signs that you could have a voice disorder. And again, trailing off at the end of sentences. And this could occur and you could be unaware. So you could be talking and you are unaware and someone would tell you, okay, say that again, or I didn't hear the last thing you said. These are kind of some of the cues that you could hear your listener present to you if you are having a voice problem and you're kind of trailing off at the end. An inconsistent production of the voice. So what this sounds like, you could be talking and you're saying, you know, happy birthday to you, and your voice just kind of gets out of control and you're not being able to control the volume of your voice. So what should you listen to or watch others say? You know, do people ask you to repeat yourself? Often, people say, can you say that again? Can you say that again? Can you say it one more time? Or they kind of move closer to you so they can start hearing you? Does your voice sound hoarse or rough or kind of scratchy more often than usual? Does anyone in your family say you're speaking softly? Oh, you're speaking so softly. Can you say that again? That's kind of the key kind of signs that you may be having a voice problem is the term softly. That you think you're speaking at a volume that is normal for you, but the listener is hearing it as soft speech. Again, a throat clear. And is your voice stronger on some days and weaker on others? So again, that fluctuation of voice. So these are just a couple of questions that you can kind of ask yourself or be aware of to see if you have a voice disorder. So again, production of speech is a highly automatic behavior. So with people with Parkinson's, with less dopamine, that automatic movement as speech is produced is disrupted. So we need to change that automatic into something else intentional, and that's where speech therapy will be involved. So with voice therapy for people with Parkinson's disease, again, we're turning that automatic task into something intentional. So voice therapy teaches people with Parkinson's how to convert speech from automatic to an intentional act. There's several kind of programs out there that are being widely used that are speaking with intent or loud, uses the less dependent on dopamine. So you're gonna have to actively engage. It's not an automatic thing. It's gonna be a workout for your voice and throat because you have to turn it on. So these are a couple of the two voice therapy options that are widely used. We have the LSVT and then the Speak Out. Just a brief description of the Speak Out. So the Speak Out involves a speech evaluation, and then you meet with a family, and then you enroll in a Speak Out therapy session, which is a which is about a 12-week course followed by a 6-week follow-up. And then you roll over. Once you graduate from Speak Out, you roll over to Loud Crowd, which is a maintenance program. The LSVT is another program that's widely used too, and this trains people with Parkinson's disease to use their voice at a more normal loudness level when speaking at home, at work, or wherever. The key to this treatment is to help people recalibrate their perceptions so they know how loud or soft they sound to other people and can feel comfortable using a stronger voice and a normal loudness level. So it's just going to recalibrate you to kind of tell your body, hey, I need to speak louder. I need to, because the listener is perceiving me as softer if I don't. So again, it's changing that automatic to an intentional, purposeful act of speaking. So again, those are just two treatments that are popularly used for treating voice. So how do we evaluate speech and voice disorders in people with Parkinson's disease? And when do you know you need an evaluation? So again, you can be aware, and also your family can be aware, that there's changes in voice, changing in your speech, the slow rate or the short rushes of speech, or people having extra difficulty understanding you. And this, you know, not the people, if you go to the store, you're going to the bank, the doctor, not the people that are unfamiliar to you. These are the people that hear you and have heard you for years, and now they are having difficulty understanding you, either because of the way you're pronouncing the words or the level of your voice. So a speech evaluation assesses, you can do a speech evaluation and voice kind of at the same time. It may start with a normal informal assessment and move to a perceptual assessment. So getting a standard of, they may have you have a reading sample and take samples of your voice. So for a speech evaluation, you must, again, like any of these disorders, have a referral from your physician. When you go to meet the SLP, she'll review your medical history and ask important questions in terms of what medications you're taking, because all that can be impacted. And you'll complete like an oral motor exam. We'll have you do some funny things with your mouth just to kind of see what your articulators, the things that are going to shape the sound, how they're moving. And we'll assess your voice through a variety of sustained vowels and pitch raises to see what your pitch control is, how loud you can get, and just general conversation. In terms of dysarthria, they also can give you a questionnaire, a self-reported questionnaire, and this is living with dysarthria evaluation. So this is kind of, we'll ask a series of questions, is just how your speech, how you're producing your words are impacting your quality of life. A key to any of the evaluations, no matter what assessment, the LSVT or their Speak Out, it's going to involve an instrumental voice evaluation. So if you have a sound level meter, and if you have a voice disorder, a voice problem, a sound level meter will be a key tool to have to monitor your loudness. So what are some of the compensatory strategies to improve speech, how you're producing words? Again, these are general strategies that can be used if you're experiencing speech difficulties. Some of them, again, would be speaking slowly if you have that short rushes of speech, increased loudness, over-articulating. Over-articulating is a key thing. It feels funny until you kind of get used to it, because you're going to over-articulate, over-pronounce certain consonants and words to help stream your speech along. Pauses between words to kind of give you that extra respiratory strength to not trail off in between words. So this will be a therapeutic approach to help you sound, improve your quality of speech and the quality of voice. And then taking a breath before you start speaking in the middle of long phrases is another therapy, compensatory strategy technique. So the treatment of this, again, this is kind of the overall big picture of how we would treat speech and voice. And again, you can have both or just one. Usually the assessment is all encompassing, so we would assess both at the same time. So the treatment principles for speech disorders would start with, we want management to start early. So the earlier we can catch it and earlier to increase your awareness, to turn it again from an automatic to an intentional thing that you have to work at it to improve. And that work at it will be gradual, right? So you won't, you know, it's work. So no one's asking you to carry 10 pounds around every single day. But let's say an hour a day, you're lifting a 10-pound weight. So it's going to be gradual over time. So management starts early. Treatment will focus on compensatory or rehabilitative strategies. So again, this is something that is going to be persistent. It's not going to go away if you just come with therapy. But it's going to give you tools that you can use when you need to use them. Improving speech requires speech. So you're going to have to talk a lot. And it's going to you talking a lot and us listening a lot and thinking of ways to help you improve your speech. And feedback is crucial into monitoring. So again, that sound level meter are recording yourself so you can have an auditory feedback. Because with a lot of people with Parkinson's disease, you're just not aware. So with that auditory feedback or even a visual feedback, if you do a recording, you can start to hear yourself, what you sound like to others. And home exercise. So again, it's going to be an exercise program that's important because that's going to require you to carry over and maintain. And then again, and lastly, the focus on, it depends on, the changes depends on the severity. So you may see a big change for a little bit, or just a gradual change. But the key is you have to stay with it. For both voice and speech, you know, I feel like they're both are qualities who you are and how you present yourself to the world. So if you feel like, you know, you're a talker and you've been a talker and now people are having a hard time understanding you, that's gonna impact your quality of life. And if you, you know, are used to going out socially or even going to the bank or going, you know, shopping, and you're used to just talking and people hearing you and not having to like have to repeat yourself. So you're finding yourself repeating yourself, then voice therapy and speech therapy will definitely be beneficial to allow you to, one, increase your awareness and then give you some tools to use when you're presented with this certain situations. So that concludes our presentation in terms of the role of speech pathologists in treating people with Parkinson's disease. If you have any questions, we'll stick around. We'll be here for you. And thank you.
All right. Thank you, Danielle and Megan. I really appreciate you including many of those compensatory strategies and activities that people can use on a daily basis. That's fantastic. Okay, so this is the part where we are going to take a brief commercial break. We're going to reset our area so that we can bring our panel back to go through the questions you all have been submitting during the previous discussions, and we will be back in a moment. Thank you. Started with the questions that the audience submitted during the live session. You're going to see that our panelists were all wearing masks because we are being mindful of the necessary social distancing precautions we should all be taking. And so we will remove the masks when we speak, but then put them back on. So I'm going to just start reading through some of these questions. Thank you all again for your presentations and for being a part of today's session. Maybe this is best for Dr. Thomas. When do speech issues start to show up in Parkinson's?
So they can show up at any stage. As we talked about before, if you have atypical Parkinson's, that might show up sooner. But it's usually kind of more in the moderate to severe parts of the disease.
So maybe several years into it.
Yes.
Okay. And if my doctor doesn't mention speech therapy, does that mean that they don't think that it's necessary? or how should I have that conversation with my doctor if I'm concerned for myself or a loved one? Mm-hmm.
Just because your doctor doesn't mention it, it might've been, sometimes, you know, at a visit, there's so many things that you're talking about and it might just get overlooked. So some of my patients come with a list of questions. So it's probably good if there's some things that are bothering you, make sure you bring it to your doctor's attention. Just because they don't mention it, it might just be that you were concentrating on something else.
Okay. There was a lot of mention about like excess saliva that can build up, but we had some questions about dry mouth. Specifically, there was a question about that some of the medications say that they cause dry mouth. How much of an issue is that typically, and what options are there for treatment, or what types of things can people do for dry mouth if that's what they're experiencing? So that maybe that's a question for Dr. Thomas and for Megan maybe to share.
Sure. I'll go first. Yeah. So the disease itself can make your mouth dry. The medicines can make your mouth dry, particularly if you're on any of the ones that have what are called anticholinergic medicines. And so working with your doctor, sometimes we have to make adjustments to the medicines, and then trying to stay hydrated, especially in the summer months. I think that that's important too.
Yeah, I agree. I think what I usually tell my patients to do is definitely try to drink as much as they can, especially in the summer, before meals as well. And then there are some over-the-counter dry mouth relief products that work pretty well. They're temporary, but they can be used before meals just to help get moisture in your mouth so that you can manage everything better. I think that's usually what I recommend. Some people ask about chewing gum. It can help, but sometimes it's drying actually. So I don't know that I would recommend chewing gum as much as I would just say like use those over-the-counter products or just drink a lot more.
So gum might be able to be used if someone had excess saliva?
Oh, for dry mouth, sorry.
Yeah.
For excess saliva, though.
I mean, would it be an option for?
I guess it could. I don't know. I've never actually thought about it for the other side. Usually
right.
I get the dry mouth side. But
gotcha.
Yeah.
Maybe. Okay. All right. Megan, you discussed earlier use of a straw, mm. and sometimes it's okay and sometimes it's not. This person asked, does it matter if I use a thick or a thin straw?
It matters in the sense that it can change how much you get at one time. If you've been in the hospital, ever been around someone in the hospital, they usually get the big jugs and they have very thick straws. And so that puts a lot of liquid in your mouth at one time. And then because it's a straw, it goes really fast towards the swallow. So I don't love those usually because it just is asking for trouble. Thin straws are going to be less volume, but it's still going to be a straw. So I think you just need to make sure that it's been like assessed to know that it's helping you or it's hurting you. What sometimes helps, like if a straw is necessary, you can pinch off the straw and just get that way. It's like a little bit of at a time that they're getting. That sometimes works. But I guess if I had to choose between the two, always go thin and not do the thick ones.
All right, great. Okay, we have a couple questions regarding speech therapy. So Danielle, this might be best for you. If you could tell us how speech therapy is kind of working now, kind of in this pandemic environment, are things, you know, can people still do speech therapy or their telehealth options?
So yes, given this new time, a lot of companies and home-based programs have switched to telehealth. So you can receive both voice and speech therapy through various platforms, via telehealth, via Zoom, or whatever platform the company is using, but it is available.
And what about apps? Someone asked a question about apps, whether or not there are apps that might help with speech therapy or voice. Is that something that they could do maybe in conjunction with or in lieu of speech therapy?
Are apps available just to monitor your decibel level, how loud you are? So if you have concerns about voice or you just kind of want to monitor what your baseline, what your voice sounds like during conversation, there are apps. You can do a DB app, a voice analysis tool app. You can just type in voice app, and I would suggest trying the free ones first and just looking to see if they're monitoring volume or your decibel level. Typically, what you're going to look for in terms of decibel level with loudness is around 70 to 80 dB in terms of conversation. So if you're speaking and it kind of falls below 70 to the 50s to the 60s, then you try to see what you can do to kind of compensate and get loud to maintain around a 70 level.
Okay. This one's also for Danielle. So we tell folks a lot with Parkinson's a lot of time to think of physical therapy as being prehabilitative rather than rehabilitative always. And so can the same be said for speech therapy, and how soon should patients do, you know, address the speech issues, or are there things that can be done kind of as a preventative measure?
So the question is it prehabilitative or rehabilitative, and what can they do to help even if the early stages?
I think what they're asking is, can speech therapy be done as a preventative measure, or is it always something that you do once you have problems?
It could be done in a preventative measure at the early on, so you can have some of those tools to monitor your own voice. So yes, it could be done early on. But typically, it's usually, I would say, the earliest signs is when people are starting to say, I can't understand you. You're speaking really softly. Say that again. That's your early signs of indicating that, okay, I need to go get my speech evaluated. So don't wait to everyone until you blame it on them, the listener, as the person who's not understanding you. Once you start hearing them tell you, I don't understand you, you're speaking softly, say that again, that could be a sign that you need to speak with your doctor and receive a evaluation for speech and voice.
Okay, so it might not always be the other person's hearing problem.
It might not be the other person's hearing problem. Right. Just consider getting an evaluation to see where the problem may lie.
Okay, great, thank you. All right, could tongue movement also be dyskinesia?
Yes. So there's, for instance, there's tardive dyskinesia, where sometimes people have been taking other medicines and it can affect how the tongue moves. And then also as part of Parkinson's, you can have dyskinesia. So just your tongue is a muscle, so it could be the case. Now, I know your next question would be, how would you be able to tell if it's dyskinesia or not? Part of it, I probably would need my speech pathologist friends to kind of evaluate you to see which one it was. But if we thought it was dyskinesia, that might mean that we need to decrease your medicine. If we thought that it was because of regular issues with your Parkinson's, we'd have to increase. So that would be a challenging thing to figure it out, but it's a good question to ask.
Okay, good. All right. Let's see. I don't know. We had a question about, could you comment on the importance of proper dentures? I suppose that could be both a chewing swallowing issue and maybe even a speech issue.
True, probably both. I definitely see it with swallowing. It depends, actually. I was going to say that it's very important to have them fit well, and you have to watch out for, if you've had significant weight loss, usually the dentures won't fit as well. So do sort of keep that in mind. There's really nothing worse than your dentures are moving everywhere while you're chewing. So it's very important to have them fit well. But at the same time, if you don't have dentures that don't fit well, it is possible to chew even tough foods without your teeth. I've seen plenty of patients do it. It just, I guess, depends on if you can tolerate that or not. But I think just making sure they're fitting while using the good denture creams. And also one kind of thing I always tell people is if you ever have to go to the hospital, really keep watch of your dentures. I've had a lot of people lose their dentures, like just on food trays or whatnot, and dentures are expensive. So that's my little plug, my PSA, watch for your dentures.
Keep track of your dentures. Okay, great. So kind of following that one a little bit, maybe, is my spouse is hesitant to make the switch to soft foods, but he's choking. So how do I encourage him to make that shift?
Oh, it's so hard. And I think one thing I didn't really mention too much in the in my presentation part was that I mentioned long-term goals, but I didn't really go into detail about it. But I think that's something that you always have to think about, like long-term, you know, what are your limits? Like, am I going to go to puree foods, or like, I refuse, you know, and that you have the right to do that.
if you're just going from like a regular hamburger, I obviously have hamburgers on my mind because I keep bringing that up today. if you have, if it's just from like going to a hamburger to just something a little bit softer, I feel like that you can really talk someone into that a little bit easier. What I usually tell people is to add like sauces to things or gravies to things. So it still will look the same. It just softens the food a little bit. You can also try cutting things into smaller bites. So if you have to have that hamburger, try to put that ketchup and mustard on there to soften it. And then maybe try to cut it up a little bit so that there's not as much going into the mouth at one time. I think that's probably the easiest way to modify the food. And I think it's a lot of education. Like, this is not safe. Like, you're choking on this. You know, it's going to lead you going to the hospital. We don't want you going to the hospital, things like that. But also keeping in mind the long-term plan, you know, like if your swallowing is expected to get worse, you know, what are your goals for yourself? Do you think about going to that puree diet eventually, or do you never want to do that? You know, there's also options for like milkshakes that you can put, like Ensure milkshakes. I've done that before, where you still get a lot of calories and proteins, but it's not, you know, you don't have to like modify the diet too much. So there's also those things. But yeah, I think just always keep in mind your long-term goals, and then hopefully those are good suggestions for now.
All right, great. Let's see. So Megan, sorry to make you just keep talking here, but are there exercises that you can do to either strengthen the build up muscles in the throat or prevent swallowing issues in the future? Like things you can do now?
So yes, you can. So a lot of times with our cancer patients actually who've had radiation, we will go ahead and put them on a swallow program with the knowledge that the potential their swallow will get worse because of radiation. So this is that's a different case. So in that, but it is possible to do preventative swallowing exercises. I don't know which ones I would recommend because everyone's different. And so I think that for preventative, eating and drinking is the best thing for our swallow. So keep eating and drinking as much as you can, and that's safe and healthy. But then as problems develop, get the assessment done so that the speech therapist will know exactly what to recommend for you. But there are exercises that can help with strengthening the muscles in certain stages. I think when it gets to the more later stages, severe, you're looking at more compensatory. But yes, for the mild, moderate phases there are, but just make sure you get them assessed correctly.
All right. Okay. This is a very specific question for Danielle. I was a singer. As much as my speech issues are an annoyance, my difficulty with singing is in many ways impacting me even more. Are there resources that can help overcome some of this, or is it even possible?
Okay. If I understand the question correctly, she's a singer. Mm-hmm. A speech is a concern, so she's pronouncing her words fine, but is it her singing voice or is her speaking voice?
It sounds like it is the singing, difficulty with singing, I guess that she can't sing,
okay,
is impacting more than the speech issues she's experiencing.
Okay, so with singing, singing is just an extended version of your speaking voice, so I would recommend getting voice therapy with the focus of it being, one, improving your speaking voice, and then at the tail end, improving your singing voice, which is carrying notes longer and louder and maintaining pitch. But you're not going to go, your speech therapy is not going to like pitch match you to certain tones. That's something that you could bring to the session. But if you improve your speaking voice, so again, if you're speaking softly, so maybe that's something that you might, you know, want to be aware of that you might be doing. Improving your speaking voice will improve your singing voice, but you need to improve your quality, overall quality of speaking voice first, and then target your singing voice.
Right. And does speech therapy help work on things like breath support and projection and articulation?
Yes.
As well?
Yeah, so that's going to be just the foundation of both speech and voice is one, breath support. I always say your breath is like your rescue breath. It's going to save both your voice and it's going to save your articulation. And that's some of the strategies that we could work on depending on how you present, is when you need to take that breath and when to monitor that breath and what that diaphragmatic breathing will look like for your body.
Okay. There was a question about finding a speech therapist, how you go about that, and then also the LSVT, which is so popularly, you know, recommended for people with Parkinson's. What is the length? You know, what does that time commitment look like in terms of how long those sessions are and how long they go? And does everyone with Parkinson's need LSVT, or is traditional speech therapy also appropriate?
That's a lot of questions.
That's a lot of questions.
Right? A lot of questions
right.
That's
in like four questions.
So I think the first part was
finding a speech therapist.
Finding a speech therapist. Typically, your PCP would have a referral or have a list of people that speech therapists that are in your area. You can also look for HAPS will have resources.
That is true.
So we'll have resources for speech therapy. So they'll be available. But you want to have a speech therapist that has some experience with voice. Just because it's a specialized, as you see, speech therapists can cover a variety of areas. And they all are trained in every areas. But preferably, you want a speech therapist that has experience with treating people who have voice disorders. The second part of that question was the LSVT. The LSVT is an intense program. I believe it's like 6 weeks of intense therapy. So it's not a year-long kind of program. It's really short burst intense therapy with a carryover component to it. And so is the loud crowd and speak out. So it's intense therapy, short therapy. So you learn the techniques, you do it, you monitor your voice, and then you have to monitor it yourself, either for a loud crowd, you come and meet on weekly basis with a group, or with LSVT, you monitor it yourself. In terms of, do you need to do an LSVT or speak out to get voice or speech therapy? Not necessarily. If your speech therapist has experience in treating voice, there are components of just general voice therapy that they can apply that can be applicable to you and your problem and improve your voice. So long as they have some experience with voice and they have some tool to monitor your voice, right? So again, a decibel meter, some kind of application so you can monitor your voice and they can monitor your voice. I think any general speech therapist with experience in voice should be able to treat it. You don't have to necessarily enroll in a specific program.
Okay. Yeah, I believe LSVT is 1 hour, four days a week for 4 weeks. So okay, it is yes. Intense, mm-hmm. And then lots of homework.
Lots of homework, yes.
Okay. More questions? No. Okay. So I have a couple of additional, two more questions. One, are there any issues with the swallowing study if you've had deep brain stimulation? So I don't know if that's, I think the question was about, does the swallow evaluation use any kind of magnets or any type of equipment that might interfere with the DBS device?
I think I've done evals with deep brain, with a patient who's had a deep brain stimulator. I don't think it caused an issue.
It shouldn't cause any issues. Yeah.
Okay, great. And I think this is about probably our last question is, if I have problems swallowing, can I just crush my medications, my Parkinson's medications? Ooh.
I'll start. So, yeah. So it's always important to check with your doctor, and then sometimes the doctor even has to ask the pharmacist, because there's certain things that shouldn't be crushed just because the way that the pills are made. I guess there are certain stages of swallowing where you would recommend that they crush their pills.
Right.
And the size of the pill.
Yeah, exactly. This is what she said. I mean, the issue would be if you're, because a lot of times when you crush it, you give it like an applesauce or a yogurt. And if you have a problem with residue in your throat, you don't want that left over after. So that's the only issue. But mm-hmm. It is an option once you've checked.
Mm-hmm. Right. Do you ever worry about, I worry about this sometimes, that if people crush their pills, like say you're giving it to someone that doesn't really want to eat, that you crush it and you put it in too large of a volume and they don't eat it all, that they're not going to get their medicine. So do you usually recommend that they put it in a smaller amount? Like not put it in the whole container of applesauce, but maybe just put it in a small, so they just have to take a few bites. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yep. Yeah. Okay. Well, I think that's all, for our questions. I'm just doing a quick scan to make sure. But yeah, I think that that wraps up our question and answer session. So thanks to all of you who submitted such great questions. This has been, I think it's been very helpful. It sounds like folks are really paying attention to speech and swallowing issues. And I think it also sounds like being proactive and a good self-advocate is important in this case as well. So you all, these may not necessarily be issues that are coming up in doctor's appointments regularly, but you know, it's a good opportunity for people or family members to address the issues to make sure that folks are getting what they need nutritionally, but also staying safe and making sure that their medications are working well as well. So, okay, if you are not able, next up is our movement lab with Dr. Maggie Abbott. If you're not able to stick around to move with us, I want to just take a minute to thank all of you again for joining us and to thank our sponsors for their generous support of our educational programs this year and to thank our speakers. I will say that I think that with four of us wearing Hawaiian shirts, I think this is the first time that we've had all of the speakers and everyone involved, you know, fully engaged in the theme. So we appreciate you embracing the theme and coming out and donning the masks and shifting to the online format. We appreciate that. So again, this session will be available online in the coming weeks. Our July and August sessions are now open for registration online. They too will be webinars that we'll be hosting since we're just not sure what the current environment is going to allow us to do going forward. And you can find the handouts online at hapsonline.org, or if you need to contact the HAPS office, please feel free to reach out. As a reminder, HAPS is always here to help. So please reach out if you need anything. We are going to take another brief break as we prepare the space for Maggie's exercise movement lab. But I'm going to go ahead and introduce her now so that when she gets started, she's just going to get started. Dr. Abbott holds her doctorate of physical therapy from Texas Women's University and has been in practice since 2010. She joined HAPS as an exercise instructor in 2016, and in 2019, she joined HAPS as a full-time staff as our director of outreach. You can find her weekday mornings on Facebook, Leading Mornings with Maggie. She is a beloved instructor and a very valued member of our team. So we are going to set up for her next, and then she'll be back with an exercise program for you to join in. Thank you.
excited to be doing this movement exercise lab with you guys. Thank you for sticking around. We're gonna get started in a chair, so have a seat. All right, we're gonna twist. Take a leg. Here we go, in and out. Follow along. Good. Other side, get that foot twisting. Take the hands. Round, round, up, down, circle. Again. Circle. Twist those legs faster. Other side. Okay, we're gonna stand up, all right? You're leaning forward, all the way up. Tuck your hips under. Go ahead and start twisting. Now, something different, side to side with your hips. Push that booty back. Okay, on your toe, slow, big twist. Arms moving. Other side when you're ready. Switch sides. Switch again. Squat down. Round and round. Up. Down. Circle. Big twist here. Other side. Keep going. Excellent. Next one. Standing apart. Get that heel. Good. Hand flicks with the heel. Flick, two, three, four. Down, two, three, four. Up, down, again, up, down. Other side, heel. Push into that heel. Flick your hand. One, two, three, four. Down. Up. Down. Smooth. Down. Up. Down. Good. Heel. Both sides. Lean your hips. Good. Pick a leg, opposite arm. Up, two, three, four, down. Up, smooth here, up, down. Up, down, good. Both feet. Good, bring your hands. Okay, other side. Smooth. Here we go. Opposite hand, up and down. Flick, two, three, four, down. Keep going. One, two, three, four, down. Push in that heel. Up. Down. Smooth here. Arm smooth, leg going. Good. Toes. Totally different. Good job. Good job. Next one. Gonna go down, two, up. Squat, two, up. Down and up. Got it? down, up, keep it going. Down, up, down, up, down. Okay, you're on your surfboard. Lean back and forward. Okay, if you're ready, add those arms. Good. Back to the middle. Down. One, two, up. Watch here. Down. Down. Up. Down. Okay, surfboard's going the other way. Feel the weight shift. Okay, add your hands. Back to the middle. Good. We're gonna go back and forth, but pause here. Back, forth. Other side. Forth, back. Good, come to the middle. Find your favorite surfboard. Keep it here till the end. Reaching. Good job. Good job. Take a breath. Excellent. We're going to move for this one. Chair for support. If you're sitting down, just do anything you can, arms or legs. Here we go. Two steps. Two. We're going to keep going here. Add your dance. All right, lifting the foot up, lift it up, lift. Good. Here, arms. Good. Feet. Gonna go in a square. Side, back, side, front, side, back. Again. Good. Stay here. Get low. Arms. Do what you can. One, two. Add your arms. Get low for me. Arms. Ready for a box? Other way. I'm gonna go back. Here we go. Back. Side. Front. Side. Big steps. Last box here. Okay, two steps. Here we go. One, two, one, two. Add your arms here. Can you go up here? We'll go arms, change, out, out, clap. Okay. Okay, stop here. Square. Side, back. Side, front. Side, back. Side, switch. Reverse. Back, side, front, side. Okay, back to two steps. One, two. Pull down. Good job. Remember this one? We're gonna change the arms. Out and out, because we're gonna clap. All right, my friends. Here we're going to start with the foot out in front. So grab your support surface. Tap the toe out in front, standing tall. To the side now. Good. Front side. Front side. Front side. Keep going. Switch your legs. We're going to go side to side, but step on it for me. Good. Okay. Other leg, tap the toe in front. Ideally, you're holding over here. Side. Good. Go front again, please. Here we go. To the side. All right. A few front side. Front side. Front side. Good. Opposite leg, stepping across. Back, front. Lean on that foot. Back, front. Try to get it across. Good. Out, cross. Out, cross. Stepping, cross. Step, cross. Other side. Front, cross. Out, cross. Okay, straight leg up for me. Out and out. Out. Doing great. Switch legs. Throwing a lot at you. Good. Holding on if you need. Okay, back to tapping. Side. Front side. Other leg, front, tap. One, two, side. Good. Front side. Good job. Front side. Good. Switch your legs. Switch again. You ready? Switch again. Good job, friends. Keep it up. Whew. Breathe here. Breathe in again. Big breath. Great job. Great job. Okay. All right, we're gonna go two steps to the side. like we did before. This is our last song. Cool down. Take your hands away. Give your best shot at this one. Can you even look at them? Good. Widen your stance. Take an arm, cross. Good. Do that again. Out. Cross. We're going to go one, two, three, four. Out. Come across. One, two, three, four. Out. Come across. One, two, three, four. Two steps. Add your hands. Okay, other side across. Hold it here, then one, two, three, four. Out and across. Here we go. One, two, three, four. Out, cross. Down, two, three, four. Out, cross. Down, two, three, four. Good. Excellent. Grab your chair. Big steps to get in front. Edge of your chair, hamstring stretch. Straight leg, lean forward, back straight. Other leg. Great work. Hope you worked hard. Okay, all right, arm across. Pull it into you. Other side. Arm across, pull it into you. Excellent. Good. Both hands open. Stretch the chest. Great. Hands to me. Put them together. Stretch them forward. Excellent. Good. All right. We're going to lean to the side. Stretch down here. Let your neck hang. Other side. Yay. All right. Well, thank you so much, everyone, for joining me for that movement lab. Excellent work. We've really appreciated your time today. Thank you so much from the HAPS staff, the whole HAPS team. We're so glad that this webinar was a success. Thank you to our sponsors, to our speakers, and we will see you at the next one. Bye, everybody.